so Heather and I have talked a long time about actually start, like, just for fun talk, not seriously, but we always like the imagination type thing. It was like, imagine if we started a school.
Yeah.
And we started with this premise of like teaching people not necessarily the Pythagorean theorem or, you know, was Columbus a good guy or a bad guy, but literally like about these things.
Yep.
And what would that do? And also what we would do. And I think we've talked about this before, like what would we do for a school curriculum in total? But we also talked about like, what are taxes and what is a mortgage? And, you know, how do you like get, you know, ahead? And, you know, what are assets and liabilities? And if you start talking about those types of things, like how cool of a fun of a school would that be? Also with these five factors layered in.
We are here because we know the outcomes in our lives are within our control. That taking absolute ownership of how we eat, sleep, train, think, and connect with each other is how we'll optimize our health and happiness. That chasing excellence is how we grab hold of what is possible. Our mission is to live on the run, always chasing, never stopping. Hello, and welcome back to another episode of the Chasing Excellence podcast. Ben is currently taking his sweatshirt off. I asked him if he was ready, and then he said yes, and then he took his sweatshirt off. Hold on.
Not everyone watches this, Patrick. Most people just listen. So they would not have.
Okay. Yeah. Well, now I can ask my question.
Yes. I'm ready.
Ask the question, which is, how you doing?
I'm doing good. Thank you.
Good. All right. Today we're going to dive into a conversation, a subject that I'm kind of excited to hear your thoughts on. I had this idea. I'm sure somebody sent me a message or a question that kind of triggered this question, but I thought it was bigger or would be fun to kind of dive into in and of itself. And it's the idea of what would you, if you were given, I don't know in what universe this would happen, but if you were given, you know, carte blanche at a high school and they said, Ben, we love you. We love what you're doing. Please come in and design our, and fill in the blank. Maybe it's a phys ed program. Please come in and design our health program. Please come in and talk, you know, tell us what to do and we'll make the kids do it. And so I kind of wanted to just broadly just kind of present that to you and see where your mind would go in this kind of scenario. Like, where would you begin thinking about, you know, super let's just cool. say we're talking about sophomores, yeah. juniors, kind of that age range. Where would you begin to kind of construct or design an effective health program for them? And then there goes the headphones.
Oh, yeah. So the headphones are going to fall out probably three or four times during this episode. So we'll just kind of deal with it as that happens. Okay. I have the tiniest little baby ears and these ear pods. Is that what they're called?
Yeah, AirPods.
They're made for giants. All right. So the question, where would I start the construction of this health curriculum for high school age kids? All right. So here's the overarching part of this is I would lean, no surprise, anybody that's listening to this podcast, I would lean into the five factors. Mm. So that being how these students, how they eat, how they train, how they sleep, how they think, and how they connect with each other, their relationships essentially, and relationships not just with each other, but with other relationships in their lives. From there, what I would bring this is not, I would not do this at a textbook level at all. I would do this at a real life level. I would have each of these students basically be their own laboratory. Mm-hmm. And that's, I'm saying do experiments on them. I would do this much like we do in the gym. Our gym is essentially a laboratory where we try to create better human beings.
Yep.
And I would have each one of these students be their improvements throughout the semester would be their score. And I would test them and I would put scores this. It would not be a gym class. It would not be a health class. This would not be like, okay, let's learn about, you know, whether it's not a biology class. This would not be – so what I mean by that is not like let's play dodgeball. It's not that at all. The movements and the training would be a CrossFit class for sure. Now, infinitely scalable and appropriate for each individual athlete for sure, but also measurable, observable, and repeatable data. After every workout, you get a score. And after every score, that score gets displayed to everybody on a, call it a leaderboard if you want to, whatever you want, but That's what I would do. This would not be the type of thing where it's like, oh, you know, if Johnny gets a D minus, then we're going to keep it. It's not, and it's also not everyone gets a ribbon. It's not everyone gets an A minus because it's gym class. Mm-hmm. I would put the numbers up there. Now, how I graded people from A to B might not be who's the fittest. It might be who makes the biggest gains, or it might be based off of effort, or it might be who could improve their ability to maintain their lactic threshold, or it could be a bunch of different other stuff. Yep. So that would be the training aspect. Would be certainly CrossFit, and it would be constantly varied functional movements for relative high intensity and measurable, observable, repeatable data. So we're doing science at that point. The eating, I would have them read the stuff that I have my athletes and my coach read, which are just like, I would have them read stuff like by Rob Wolf and Michael Pollan and Mark Sisson. I would have them listen to Chris Kresser, and I would have them go into the resources that I believe espouse the right way to eat. Mm-hmm. And then I would have these athletes log and record their eating as they go through this. And I would use basically their own ability, their own discipline. Like, we do this in school for math. How come we can't do it for health? Mm-hmm. Like, you require people to learn something and then you test them on it. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing here. I'm gonna require you to learn how to eat in a healthy way, and then I'm gonna test you on your ability to do that. And I would bring this into it. It wouldn't be hypothetical, it wouldn't be theoretical. You're not being tested on, tell me how many calories are in a gram of protein. Yep. What I want to know is, what are you eating for protein? Mm-hmm. Are you going to McDonald's, or are you having grass-fed burger? Mm-hmm. Like, that matters to me. And I don't want to get into like the whole like, well, you can't afford it and stuff like that. Like, you said, I don't know what universe this is, and I don't know what universe it is either. okay. So that's the training. That's the eating. For sleep, I would give everyone a Whoop and I would track their sleep. With that, it also measures their stress levels, their HRV, and resting heart rate. We can learn a lot. And all of a sudden, if little Johnny is having a hard time in school, it may be because little Johnny is staying up until 2:30 a.m. playing Minecraft, with his buddies. And all of a sudden, we have that data, and we can start to learn and start to figure things out together. Then from there, now we have training, eating, and sleeping. The next thing I would go into is mindset. Mm-hmm. And I would talk all about, and I would have them practice, and I have them read the right things. The first book I would have them read, the very first book before any of the nutrition things or anything else, would be Mindset by Carol Dweck.
Yep.
And we would dive deep into what is a fixed mindset and what is a growth mindset. We would dive deep into how it's modal specific. You could have a growth mindset in academics, but a fixed mindset in athletics. And we would work everyone over towards the growth mindset across all paradigms and modalities.
Yep.
Then from there, we would learn about other things like grit, and we would learn other things about mental fitness and overcoming obstacles and setting goals. And we would read, Obstacle is the Way, and we would read all these things that would set these guys up for success. In addition to that, layered in, I would layer in The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. This would be my health curriculum. Mm-hmm. And it would not be specific to just like a gym class, the way that most people do health. Or maybe that's PE, physical education. Other people have health, and health is about like the reproductive organs. Yep. It's like, what the hell I get that. We could learn that in a week, and then let's move on to the things that are going to affect people for the rest of their lives. Mm-hmm. Most notably, teach these people how to learn. Mm. Like that's so massively important. So I might even call it health. I might even call it like life success 101. And yes, these five factors fall into life success 101. And the last one being connections. And that's where we're going to learn about not only what is emotional IQ, with the EQ, not only what is people smarts, but what creates fulfillment, what creates happiness, what is happiness, what is fulfillment, what is Maslow's hierarchy of needs, what does it mean to find belonging, what does it mean to find self, actualization, what does it mean to satisfy these needs and look for the next? And I would dig hard into all of those aspects. And then you kind of realize how important these relationships are, what people can do to have better relationships, and what to do when they struggle with certain relationships. And to me, that would be the five pillars I would layer into what would be a requirement, what should be a requirement in a quote unquote health class inside of high school. And really, I'd like to start this even earlier, probably in with certain aspects in middle school, and for certain aspects even in elementary school, probably more the physical side in elementary school, but loosely tied to. And you know, we're lucky enough that our young kids go to public schools, you know, kindergarten and first grade, and our public school is phenomenal with growth mindset. They are so they love when the kids make mistakes. It's not a matter of being smart, being dumb. It's about trying. That's so phenomenal. And they say like, oh, the kid's like, I'm not good at math. And they're like, maybe you're not good at math yet, but you're working hard. And if you work, it's like the language that they use is so strong. So I think that, you know, we could talk ad nauseum about whether, you know, like education reform as a whole, but saying in that the paradigm in that little this little world of health curriculum, I think that should be vastly expanded, because to me, health is not just understanding, you know, what a boner is. It's, you know, it's, you know, I think it's the first time we use the word boner on this podcast, but but understanding what is health, and health is that comprised of those five things. Actually, it's more than that. It also has to do with your habits and your vices. It also has to do with your genetics. It also has to do with your environment. So we can layer those things on as well, because those just aren't as controllable. You know, I'm starting to lean more and more into the environment one actually is more controllable than we give it credit for. But that's where I'd start. That would be the – that's – hope that sets the stage for whatever else you're going to ask me.
Well, I mean, the first one is, why do you think, you know, obviously your best guess, why do you think a health program, a PE, a gym program, the ones that we went through and that kids are still going through, why do you think they're so different from what the ideas that you just laid out? Why, like, it feels like it literally, I know I set this up as an alternate universe, but it does feel like what you just set up is an alternate universe to the one that we all grew up in and the one that still kind of exists. Any guess, any idea, any sense of why there's such a gap between what you just described and what the reality at least seems to be?
Yeah, because the policymakers that created it didn't know what health was. Period. I mean, that's it. So to the point where, and we don't need to go down the political rant about the medical community, but the medical community does not know how to create health. They know how to, they're really, really good at curing sickness. That's what the medical community does, is they cure the sick through surgeries and medications. And thank God they do that. When someone is dying, they need a lifeguard to rescue them. Doctors and the medical community rescue people. What people need before they're drowning is a swim coach to teach them how not to drown. There's a difference between being a lifeguard and a swim coach. And we've confused that. We've gone like, okay, as long as these people are playing dodgeball twice a week, they're moving. And everything else is just because it's not a part of being a healthy human being. They haven't figured it out. Even the doctors, the really good doctors. So it's what most doctors, if you come in with a symptom, they say, here's some medication to cure that symptom. The good doctors go, okay, here's your symptom. Let's figure out what's causing that symptom, right? And from there, let's try to figure out how to fix that. And usually it's through exercise and nutrition. They say you need to exercise more and eat better. That's how far we've gotten in the medical side. And that's kind of, unfortunately, that's a little bit of the trailblazing side. Now there are functional medicine practitioners, a whole new field that's coming about, that are actually really rooting the cause and doing a really good job. And they're seeing where this fits in inside of all of those factors. They're not just saying like, here's medication. They're going like, tell me about your life. Tell me a day in the life of Patrick. You go through it and they're like, sounds to me like you're not sleeping. And they, oh, Like, okay, yeah, I know I'm not sleeping. I'm a hard charger. Like, I only sleep 4 hours a day. I've got, you know, I'm an entrepreneur and I'm in Silicon Valley and I don't need to. Sleep is for the weak. And they go, well, yeah, but that's why you're here. That's why you're sick. Like, we think it might be because, and the only now are we starting to come around to, like, there's more of these factors associated with health. And the policymakers in place, much like the policymakers that instituted the nutrition requirements through the 50s and 60s, who were so misled by Ansel Keys and the low-fat movement, were duped, were swayed, were, you know, they had the cloth pulled over their face, and they're like, okay, let's put out a policy about, you know, everyone should have, you know, 6 to 11 servings of cereal and bagels and pasta. And all of a sudden, this little tiny problem where our president had a heart attack, they freaked out. Now it goes from this little tiny thing, heart disease, to the number one killer in America because of the policy that they put in place. As I said, I wasn't going to go on a political rant. Here I go.
How do you think, again, in the construction of this and in the execution of this idea, given the audience for this, given that they're young, they're teenagers, they're maybe even a little bit younger, as you mentioned. How or where do you start to talk to them about the value of these kinds of ideas, these kinds of practices, these kinds of habits, given that that's especially a time in our lives where we don't think we, you know, we think we're invincible. We think we're going to live forever. We feel great because we're 15 and everybody feels great at 15. Like, how do you start to talk to them about the importance of these things when these things are to a large degree, they're kind of investments in the future, in their own future? How do you get them to think about that as an investment such that when the Pop-Tart comes in front of them, they're like, actually, you know what? I'm not interested in that.
Yeah. I don't think you're going to get through to them by talking about the future. Most 13, 14, 15 year olds could care less about what's going to happen to them when they're 50, 60, and 70.
Right.
So you're talking about now.
Yep.
Like now. Dude, like even 15 and 16, 17 year olds want to look better.
Yep.
Like, so even 15, 16, and 17 year olds want to be better on the baseball field.
Yep.
Even 15, 16, 17 year olds want to get better grades, have better mental acuity. They want to be. Yeah, exactly. Yep. So you put it in tangible things that they want to do right now. So it has to be. It has to be relative to their wants and needs. Yep. If it's esoteric, if it's too aloof, if it's too in the distant, especially as a teenager, who their most important thing is what somebody just said about them on Instagram, like you're going to lose them.
Yeah, so it's probably on TikTok now, just so you know. It's probably
right. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. I think that that's smart. What do you think, where do you think that there is a parallel to these ideas that you're talking about? And let's just say a really good sports program, right? A really good baseball program at the school, or a field hockey or a football, whatever. Do you think that, again, a really good sports program, not to use a sport pun, but kind of tackles some of these things, or even is that too much to ask for from a football team or a basketball team or whatever?
So if I was the coach of a high school basketball team and I did not talk to my athletes about sleep, like, I am leaving cards on the table.
Yeah.
If I am a basketball coach and I do not talk to them about their strength and conditioning, their training, like, what am I doing? Like, if I'm leaving this only to the transactional aspects of the X's and O's of the sport of basketball, I am so understating my role and responsibility as a coach and also my opportunity to improve their abilities as basketball players. I can affect them not only during the season, but for the rest of their lives in this leadership position I have. But not only that, by doing this, I'm going to maximize their ability within the confines of the court this season. So which of those things in those five factors, training, eating, sleeping, nutrition, their mindset, so mental toughness, we call it in sports, and connection, we call it teamwork. Which of those five things would we want to leave off the table?
Right.
Like, if we're leaving any one of those off the table, we're potentially leaving 20% of the potential of this athletic team untapped. It seems irresponsible to me at best, and hurtful, more likely, to not include those things.
Do you think that, you know, we've talked a fair amount about the new leadership at CrossFit, where they're attention seems to go, where what they might become, what they might, what Eric Rosa might want to lead towards. Do you think, can you imagine, can you know how or what would you imagine a role for CrossFit HQ in this kind of conversation? Like, do you imagine that CrossFit HQ will at some point say, okay, if we want to tackle, if we still, we want to continue to tackle, you know, metabolic disease, we want to, all this stuff, we've actually got to go upstream. We've got to get to middle schoolers and high schoolers. Do you imagine that this is an avenue or a place or space that is ripe for them to come and say, here's the CrossFit health high school curriculum? And and work with schools and work with leaders at schools to actually implement that.
So we've, so Heather and I have talked a long time about actually start, like just for fun talk, not seriously, but we always like the imagination type thing. It was like, imagine if we started a school and we started with this premise of like teaching people, not necessarily the Pythagorean theorem or, you know, was Columbus a good guy or a bad guy, but literally like about these things.
Yep.
And what would that do? And also what we would do. And we, I think we've talked about this before, like what would we do for a school curriculum in total? But we also taught them about like, what are taxes and what is a mortgage and, you know, how do you like get, you know, ahead and, you know, what are assets and liabilities? And if you start talking about those types of things, like how cool of a fun of a school would that be? Also with these five factors layered in.
Yep.
So that, that part of it is kind of fun to dream about. I think we're a long ways off from that. I think what we're not so far away from is probably what you're alluding to is there are schools right now, the first one happened in Massachusetts, St. John's, that have CrossFit classes for credits. So that's kind of cool. Now, I think when they're doing those CrossFit classes for credits, I think, I don't know this, but my understanding is it's kind of like CrossFit in a gym. So it's really kind of like focused on the training aspect. I would really love for CrossFit to get more involved in the additional aspects of what we see as health. To be talking about the nutrition, to be talking more about the quote unquote lifestyle factors, talking about the things that happen between your ears in terms of the mental adaptations and the approach we can bring to life. And if there's ever been a time for this to happen, a guy like Eric Rosa seems to be the guy that would kind of spearhead this thing. He's certainly all about the growth of the platform, about the brand, and he realizes that he needs to get, I shouldn't say needs to, he is excited, from my understanding, to get the younger crowd involved in this, as you mentioned, like going upstream. And that's really where you can start to instill these really good habits. The other thing which I'm pretty excited to see is we have, you know, the numbers are kind of fuzzy, but somewhere, you know, in the 3 to 5 million people doing CrossFit. They're going to raise a generation of kids. And that generation that they raise is going to be, you know, 10 to 20 million kids. And there's going to be more people that fall into this thing in the meantime. We could have a whole, the next generation, like, honestly, this could be, everyone talks about like the next, you know, millennials, like with like a wet towel type thing. It's like, you know, the, first off, I think millennials are incredible. So I'm not, I don't fall into that camp at all. The fact that they want, people blame them because they want to make impact. Like that's the best thing that you can put to somebody. Yes. Oh my, like who are these kids that want meaning? Who are these kids that want impact? Like what? Where are these people that just want to sit behind a, like be a
be
cog
miserable like us.
Yes, exactly. I totally lost my train of thought there. Oh, the whole next generation of CrossFitters. Like this could be like really like leapfrog, not to get too bold and crazy out there, but like the human race could take a massive step forward. I'm not saying CrossFitters are like the magic people in the world, but in terms of the approach that they bring, yeah, this would be pretty powerful. You know, if we had all of a sudden, you know, if we have 10,000 people, 10 million people doing CrossFit in, you know, 10 years, well, when those people raise and we have the 50 million people, that's kind of cool.
Yeah. I mean, if you and Heather want to start the five factors, you know, charter schools, let me know. I'll be there.
I'm five factors.
Yeah, the Five Factors Institute. I'll be there. All right, my friend, that was fun. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Thank you to everybody who sends us questions like that one, who leaves ratings and reviews. And we will be back next week for another episode of Chasing Excellence. You can get every episode of Chasing Excellence wherever you listen to your podcasts or on YouTube. Until next time, thank you for listening.